Srila Prabhupada once wrote this poem in the offering to his spiritual master, and his spiritual master particularly liked one line. Anyone know what that line is of that poet? The line of the poet, when his spiritual master saw it, he said, "Yes, he has understood my heart." And the line of the poet was, "Absolute is sentient, thou hast proved. Impersonal calamity, thou hast moved." And when Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati saw that, he was very happy. Absolute is sentient, that the supreme divinity is a person. He has emotions, he has personality, he has relationships. Thou hast proved, you proved that. Impersonal calamity, the danger, the spiritual suicide of impersonalism, thou hast removed or moved. You have removed that. And so Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was very much on a campaign against the Mayavadis. So Srila Prabhupada understood that. And therefore Srila Prabhupada was also glorified. What do we say? Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Tarini. He's removing the impersonalism from the world. So yes, this is Srila Prabhupada's mission. This is why Srila Prabhupada wrote all of these books. So we're continuing to read from the fifth canto of the Bhagavatam. This is chapter 19, the island of Jambudvip. And we're reading from text number 3, and then we'll read from text number 4, because there's no purport. And it's a prose verse, so I'll just say it myself. Om namo bhagavate uttama shlokaya namat arya lakshana shila vartaya nama ukshikshat mana upashita lokaya nama saduvada nikashanaya namo brahmanya devaya maha purushaya maha rajaya nama iti. Translation. Let me please your lordship by chanting the Bija mantra Omkar. I wish to offer my respectful obeisances unto the personality of Godhead, who is the best among the most highly elevated personalities. Your lordship is the reservoir of all the good qualities of the Aryans, people who are advanced. Your character and behavior are always consistent, and you always control your senses and mind. Acting just like an ordinary human being, you exhibit exemplary character to teach others how to behave. There is a touchstone that can be used to examine the quality of gold, but you are like a touchstone that can verify all good qualities. You are worshipped by brahmanas, who are the foremost of all devotees. You, the Supreme Person, are the King of Kings, and therefore I offer my respectful obeisances unto you. So we read from text number 4. Yatad vishudhanubhava matramekam. Svatejasa dvasta guna vyavastam pratyak prashantam sudiyo palambanam yanamarupam niraham prapadye. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Śrīla Bhaktivedānta Swāmī Śrīla Prabhupāda ki jaya. The Lord, whose pure form, Sachidānanda Vigraha, is uncontaminated by the modes of material nature, can be perceived by pure consciousness. In the Vedānta, He is described as being one without a second. Because of His spiritual potency, He is untouched by the contamination of material nature. And because He is not subject to material vision, He is known as transcendental. He has no material activities, nor has He a material form or name. Only in pure consciousness, Krishna consciousness, can one perceive the transcendental form of the Lord. Let us be firmly fixed at the lotus feet of Lord Ramachandra, and let us offer our respectful obeisances unto those transcendental lotus feet. Purport. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, appears in various expansions as stated in Brahma Samhita 539. Ramadi Murti Shukala Niyame Natistan Nana Vatara Makarod Bhuvane Shukintu Krishna Svayam Samabhavat Paramam Pumanyo Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. I worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Govinda, who is always situated in various incarnations, such as Ram, Nishimha, and many sub-incarnations as well, but who is the original personality of Godhead known as Krishna and who incarnates personally also. Krishna, who is Vishnu Tattva, has expanded himself in many Vishnu forms, of which Lord Ramachandra is one. We know that the Vishnu Tattva is carried by the transcendental bird Garuda, and is equipped with different types of weapons in four hands. Therefore, we may doubt whether Lord Ramachandra could be in the same category, since he was carried by Hanuman, not by Garuda, and had neither four hands nor the Shankha, Chakra, Gada and Padma. Consequently, this verse clarifies that Ramachandra is as good as Krishna, Rama di Murti Shukala. Although Krishna is the original Supreme Personality of Godhead, Ramachandra is not different from him. Ramachandra is unaffected by the modes of material nature, and therefore he is prashanta, never disturbed by the modes, by those modes. Unless one is saturated with love for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one cannot appreciate the transcendental value of Lord Ramachandra. One cannot see him with material eyes. Because demons like Ravan have no spiritual vision, they consider Lord Ramachandra an ordinary Kshatriya king. Ravana therefore attempted to kidnap Lord Ramachandra's eternal consort, Sita Devi. Actually, however, Ravan could not carry off Sita Devi in her original form. As soon as she was touched by Ravan's hand, she gave him a material form, but she maintained her original form beyond his vision. Therefore, in this verse, the words Pratyak Prashantam indicate that Lord Ramachandra and his potency, the goddess Sita, keep themselves aloof from the influence of the material energy. In the Upanishads, it is said, Yam evaisha vrinute tena labhya. The Supreme Lord Paramatma, the Personality of Godhead, can be seen or perceived only by persons who are saturated with devotional service, as stated in Brahma Samhita 5.38. Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena Santasa Devaridayeshu Vilokayanti Yam Shyama Sundaram Echintya Guna Swarupam Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. I worship the primeval Lord Govinda, who is always seen by the devotee whose eyes are anointed with the pulp of love. He is seen in his eternal form of Shyam Sunda, situated within the heart of the devotee. Similarly, in the Chandogya Upanishad, it is said, Etas Teshro Deva Devata Anena Jivena. In this verse of the Chandogya Upanishad, the word anena is used to distinguish the Atma and Paramatma as two separate identities. The words Dishro Devata indicate that the body of the living entity is made of three material elements, fire, earth and water. Although the Paramatma enters the heart of the Jivatma who is influenced and designated by a material body, the Paramatma has nothing to do with the Jivatma's body, because the Paramatma has no material connections. He is described here as Anamarupam Niraham. The Paramatma has no material identity, whereas the Jivatma does. The Jivatma may introduce himself as Indian, American, German, and so on. But the Paramatma has no such material designations, and therefore he has no material name. The Jivatma is different from his name, but the Paramatma is not. His name and he himself are one and the same. This is the meaning of Niraham, which means without material designations. The word cannot possibly be twisted to mean that the Paramatma has no ahankara, no I-ness or identity. He has transcendental identity as the Supreme. This is the explanation given by Srila Jiva Goswami. According to another interpretation given by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Niraham means Nirnischayena Aham. Niraham does not mean that the Supreme Lord has no identity. Rather, the stress given by the word Aham proves strongly that he does have his personal identity, because Nir not only means negative, but also strong ascertainment. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Om Agyanati Mirandhasi Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalan Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dhinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priya Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhunityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasudhi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. If you ever see a flower or a flower plant, then there are different stages. There is the budding stage. There is the covered stage when you can't really see the plant at all. Then there is the contracted stage when you can see something is happening. Then there is the budding stage. You don't see the flower, but you see a bud. And then you see there is the blossoming stage when gradually the bud is opening up and the flower is also opening up. And then you see the fully blossomed flower. So it's explained in Vedic teachings that the consciousness is like this. There's one type of consciousness which is known as achadita chaitana, which means completely covered consciousness. In other words, consciousness in which not so much can be expressed and also not so much can be experienced. So what kinds of a species of life do you think are in covered consciousness? Any idea? Animals comes later. Completely covered. Trees, plants, generally the unmoving, the living entities who are not moving. So plants, trees, all of these kind of living entities are known as achadita chaitana. Then little bit higher than that is something called sankuchita chaitana, which means contracted consciousness. Here there is more expression, there is more experience, but it's not fully He's not fully awakened. So that is like the animals, the beasts, the birds, the reptiles, the insects. These are known as sankuchita chetana, or contracted consciousness. Then there is mukulita chetana, which means budding consciousness. So now there is some vision of the flower, but the flower has not opened up, it's just simply a bud at the moment. So this kind of consciousness is compared to human beings, but human beings who have no consciousness or no awareness of God, atheistic human beings. So yes, there is more consciousness, there's more experience, but it's still covered because we can say that they are not in contact with the Supreme Truth. Then higher than mukulita consciousness is vikashita chetana, which means blossoming consciousness. And this is consciousness in which, yes, the flower is now opening up. And this is compared to human beings who have taken up some endeavor on the spiritual path. So the sadhakas are said to be in this category. Blossoming consciousness. So everyone, you can see within the movement, they are practicing, hearing and chanting. They may not be pure devotees, but we can say their consciousness is beginning to blossom like a flower opening up. And then finally, there is Purna Vikashita Chaitana, which means fully blossomed consciousness. This is the pure devotee. This is the one who has developed love for Krishna. And this is the one who is, because of their love, premanjana churita bhakti vilochanena, they can see that which others cannot see. Sometimes you look at all of these beautiful pictures of Srila Prabhupada, who has so many different types of expressions. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but I sometimes look at the pictures and I think, what is Srila Prabhupada seeing? I wonder what he's seeing. I wonder what he's experiencing. Sometimes you see these beautiful pictures of Srila Prabhupada taking darshan and his eyes are very watery, you can see. Premanjana churita bhakti. Yes, he is seeing something that others may not be able to see. Why? Because his consciousness is blossomed consciousness. His blossomed consciousness, and therefore the scent of love is emanating from his personality. So in this way we can see that it is love which is allowing one to see Krishna. One's perception of the spiritual reality is in proportion to how much love one has. That is the only determinant of how much you'll be able to perceive the spiritual reality. And so the great devotees, they may not on a material level have so much qualification according to material estimation. You may see someone like, for example, Gaur Kishordas Babaji, who is not having literacy. In one sense, he's not able to read. He's not able to understand so many things of the world according to material estimation. But he has the deepest vision, the deepest insight, because he has love. And therefore, even though Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was a great scholar, someone who knew so much, still he approached Gaur Kishordas Babaji and said, I want to learn from you. Really? A scholar wants to learn from an illiterate person? Because that is not the measure. That is not the measure of one's perception. In the material world, someone is considered to have higher perception if they have material intelligence. But in the spiritual sphere, one who has love, they are said to have the ones who have the highest perception. Because love means that one is freed from all lust. And what is ultimately covering one's real knowledge? Lust. Avritam jnanam etena jnanino nityavedina Kama rupena konteya dushpurena nalena cha. What does Krishna say in Bhagavad Gita? Avritam jnanametena, the original consciousness of the living entity, jnanino nityaverina, is covered by the eternal enemy of the living entity. And what is the eternal enemy of the living entity? Kama rupena konteya, is in the form of kam, lust. Dushpurena analena cha. And that lust is burning like fire. So the more one is lusty, the more one has desire for sense gratification, the while one is rooted in the selfish conception of I, me and mine, then the more one is distanced from the spiritual reality. But the more one has love, the more one is selfless, the more one has forgotten about my problems, my life, my desires, my future, the while one is just happy that yes, Krishna is in the center and I'm able to do something, then one is able to access the spiritual reality. So therefore, the definition of pure devotional service is given. Anya bhilashita shunyam jnana karma dhyanavritam anukulyena krishnanu silanam bhakti rutama. That pure devotional service means one no longer has any desires, no longer any material desires. That is an important distinction. That it's not that a pure devotee doesn't have spiritual desires. A pure devotee has many spiritual desires, but no more material desires, because those material desires block one's consciousness and awareness and block one from perceiving the spiritual reality. So yes, this is how we must qualify ourselves. We cannot push our way into the spiritual world, but we have to purify ourselves in such a way that Krishna will want to come and see us, isn't it? Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur made the statement, don't try to see God, but instead what should you do? Act in such a way that God will want to see you. It's interesting, one time Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, you know, if you see a picture of him, he wears glasses. So he had come in front of the deities for darshan, but he had forgotten to bring his glasses. So one devotee came running, he said, Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj, here are your glasses so you can take darshan. And he said, no need. How will I see Krishna? You think I will see Krishna through these glasses? Actually, I'm just coming in front of Krishna so that Krishna will see me. Because at this stage, of course, this was his humility. But he was saying, at this stage of my consciousness, I can't see Krishna. But still I come and I take darshan, not so much because I'm taking darshan of Krishna, but so that Krishna will take darshan of me. And then maybe by Krishna's merciful glance, I'll be purified. And maybe then if I'm purified, maybe then I'll be able to see Krishna. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would go into the Jagannath temple, then where would he take his darshan from? You know? You will not have been in the Jagannath temple because they don't allow you if you're not a Hindu. They also did not allow me, but somehow I snuck in through the side entrance into the Jagannath temple. But if you go into the Jagannath temple, it's a very beautiful temple room. It's quite narrow, very long. And right at the back of the Jagannath temple, there is a stamba. Understand? Stamba means like a pillar. And on top of that pillar is who? Not Jagannath. Jagannath's on the other side. On the top of the pillar at the back of the temple room is Garuda, Vishnu's carrier. And it's said that there on the Garuda Stamba, Garuda is always taking darshan of Jagannath. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would come into the temple room of the Jagannath, would he rush to the front to see Jagannath? No. What he would instead do is go to the back of the temple room and he would stand right by the Garuda Stamba. And you know what his logic was? I can't see Krishna because I don't have any love. But Krishna looks at his pure devotees. But I'm not a pure devotee either, so I can't see Krishna, neither Krishna will really be that interested in looking at me. But if I stand by the Garuda Stamba, then Krishna definitely will be looking at Garuda. And while Krishna looks at Garuda, maybe, just maybe, he will also glance at me. So that's a good technique. Sometimes when people come in the temple room, they think the best place to take darshan from is the front. But maybe you might want to consider standing behind a very sincere devotee. Because maybe Krishna will look at that very sincere devotee, and while looking at them, he may also see you. So yes, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would take darshan from there, the Garuda Stamba. So devotees, even to this day, they go to the Garuda Stamba. If you go to that Garuda Stamba, then actually there are imprints on the pillar. Because it said that when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was there taking darshan of Jagannath, then in ecstasy he was melting the pillar. So devotees go there today and they hug the pillar, knowing that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took darshan from there. So this is our spiritual life. We are trying to qualify ourselves to see Krishna. George Harrison sings in his song, "I really want to see you, I really want to see you, but it takes so long, it takes so long." Does it take long to see Krishna? What do you think? Yes? It takes a long time, isn't it? In one sense we can say yes, it takes a long time. So many lifetimes we were discussing yesterday. So far away from Krishna. But in another sense, Srila Prabhupada does say it's very easy to see Krishna. It's very, very quick process. Bhakti is a very, very quick process. Even Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, "Deshamaham samudharta mrityusam sarasagarat bhavami nachirat partha maya veshit chetasham." Krishna says, "Deshamaham samudharta, I lift them up, mrityusam sarasagarat, from the ocean of birth and death." Jai Shishi Vijay Gauranga Dwaranitai Ki. Krishna says, I lift them up from the ocean of birth and death. Bhavami Nachirat. Nachirat means in no time. No, with no delay. Very, very quickly I deliver them. So it depends. Is spiritual life quick or is spiritual life slow? If you look from the point of view of us here in the material world struggling, it feels very, very slow. Like, come on, let's go faster. But if you look from the eternal perspective, that for many, many lifetimes we were in Maya, we were traveling here and there, lost. And then in one short lifetime, you can achieve Krishna. Then you think, oh, maybe it's quite fast. So is the process of Krishna consciousness fast or slow? It depends what perspective you're looking from. If you're looking from the limited material perspective of the impatient soul in this world, then it looks like a long time. But if you look from the bigger perspective of many, many lifetimes in Maya, then you say one short lifetime just for Krishna, that's not so long, that we can do. Therefore, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur often said, "You've given so many lifetimes to Maya. Now just give one life to Krishna." You think, one life, one whole life, one long life seems to us like a long thing. But actually it's a short life in the context of so many lives. So why not? Why not give one life to Krishna and give that time? And then we become qualified to see Krishna. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he once said, "I can sum up my whole philosophy in one line." You know this? He said to his disciples once, "I can sum up the whole philosophy I'm teaching the world in one line." You know what it is? He made an aphorism called Drig Drishya Vichar. the philosophy of the seer and the seen. What's that? How does that explain the whole philosophy? He said the whole world is thinking that they are the seer and that God is seen. That they are the ones who will see God. That they are the seer and they will see God. God is the one who is seen by them. But what I'm trying to teach the world is that it's the complete opposite. That God is the seer and we are the seen. In other words, we can't force our way into seeing God, but all we can do is purify our consciousness, and then maybe one day Krishna will reveal his beauty to us. So that is what we're trying to do. That is the process of Krishna consciousness. And here in this verse, we're being told by Srila Prabhupada that God has many forms, and all of those forms, Ramadi Murti Shatal Kalani Amena Tistan, all these murtis, all of these forms are completely spiritual. And all of these forms carry the opulences and beauty of the Lord. And one should never think that the Lord is formless. Remember, Absolute is sentient, thou hast proved. We must prove that to the world, that God is a person and that we have a relationship with him. Because if this is not understood, then people will miss the supreme attainment of life. Everyone in this world is looking for rasa, for taste, for mellow, for movement of their heart. But rasa can only be experienced if there are two. If there is a lover and a beloved. If you make everything one, then there can never be any exchange. And if there's never exchange, then there's no rasa. And if there's no rasa, there's no taste which will satisfy the heart. And so the devotees, as Srila Prabhupada is doing here in the purport, always fight against this idea of Mayavad. And rather they establish, no, the Supreme Lord is a person, he's beautiful, he has so many qualities. And if you purify your consciousness and develop a little bit of love, then maybe, just maybe, you'll be able to see Krishna. And therefore Kaviraj Goswami prays, Prema dhana vina vyartha daridra jivan dasa kori vetan more deha prema dhan. That without love, prema dhana vina, if I don't have the wealth of love, daridra jivan, you must consider I am a very poor soul. Dasa kori, therefore, O Lord, make me your servant. Vetan more, and I only ask for one salary, deha prema dhan. Please give me some love. That's the only thing we ask from Krishna. We're asking otherwise for so many other things. We're asking for the wrong things. That's the problem. Srila Prabhupada once told the story of the lady in India who had a heavy load on her head, carrying on her head. In the burning midday sun, she was carrying this water pot. And then she tripped up and the water pot fell, and she said, Krishna! And somehow she was so sincere that Krishna appeared. And Krishna said, you called me. Oh wow, I didn't realize you would come. So you called me, what do you want? She said, I dropped the water pot. Can you put the water pot back on my head? Krishna said, okay. Put the water pot back on her head, continued walking under the hot blazing sun, carrying that water pot. And after some moment she realized, Krishna came to me. I could have asked for anything, but all I asked for was to put the heavy load back onto me so I could continue struggling in this world. Isn't it amazing? The things we pray for, the things we ask for, the things we desire are the very things that are going to keep us here in the material world. So therefore, there's one Christian lady saint, Saint Teresa of Avila, you may know. She said, more tears were shed from prayers that were answered than from prayers that were unanswered. Because sometimes when we're praying, when we're desiring, because we have lust, because we have material desire, we're asking for the wrong things. Therefore, let us ask for the right things, the things which will actually bring us happiness and contentment. Let us pray for love, for selflessness. Let us accept whatever situation Krishna has given us, even if sometimes it doesn't feel like it's a perfect situation. Let us accept that as the Lord's arrangement and see how within this situation we can purify our consciousness and get out. Because there's no comfortable situation in this world. Therefore, Krishna is continually making us uncomfortable so that we don't get comfortable in the illusion. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. If anyone has any comments or questions, have a few minutes if you'd like to ask anything. Yes, Dara Mataji.
We always hope, I think, until the last breath, there is something to enjoy in the material world, although we know what you say.
Yes. The hopes never seem to disappear. We still have some hopes. And this is the problem. Yes, it's actually said in Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's Madhurya Kadambini, he explains that anartha nivritti is actually going on until the stage of bhava. Until you reach prema, there's still some vestiges of anarthas or impurities in the heart, some sort of hopes, some sort of... Therefore, Bharat Maharaj was on the level of bhava. He was right there at the gates of prema, but still there was something there and he got attached, and therefore he had to come back as a deer. So yes, we realize that still we're not going to be able to give up hopes in material desires. So then what do we do? So then as devotees, what we do is we say, even though I have these hopes in these material desires, let me not invest my time and energy in them. See, in the mind there may be a hope of material desire, but what you can do as a devotee is have stronger intelligence and say, I'm not going to invest my time and energy in it though. That choice you have. You can't immediately erase the hopes of material enjoyment because those impressions are strong. But the problem comes when we invest our time, our energy in trying to pursue those material desires. Then we just run around, round and round, not getting anywhere, chasing the right thing in the wrong place. And then we feel frustrated, it's not happening. And then we feel angry at Krishna. Then we feel, no, there's no future for me because we've now invested our time and energy in pursuing those things. So even if we find ourselves, I still have some hope, by intelligence we say, I'm not going to invest in that hope. And in that way, gradually when you do that, the hopes also disappear because Krishna gives you the higher taste. You see, if you have graffiti on a wall, there's two ways to clean the wall, right? You know that one, right? The first way is you try to scrub out the graffiti, but that's very difficult. So then what do you do instead? What's the other way to make the wall clean? Just paint over it. Just paint over it. So are we going to really scrub out all of our material desires? Probably not. There's too many. Too many. Chintama parimeyam cha pralayantam upashrita kamupa bhoga parama etava diti nishchita. Krishna says that we have unlimited desires and therefore we have unlimited anxieties. So what are we going to do with these unlimited desires? We can't just extinguish them. Therefore, we don't invest in them. And rather what we do is we invest in positive spiritual desires, and then those positive spiritual desires paint over, and then the material desires disappear. Because vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehina. When you give up the lower taste, having experienced the higher, then immediately you're fixed in consciousness. So yes, let us do that. Yes.
Thank you so much. A question about book distribution. So we are having to do with the people who have no idea of Krishna, and very often they, how to say, they also do spiritual souls. It doesn't matter if they say I'm an atheist, and then I say if you're atheist, it's very nice when you're not fanatical. But somehow, I don't know if it influences me or not.
What influences you? Being in contact with them?
Modes.
Yeah.
I don't feel it influences me, but the question if maybe I don't feel. Maybe doch, how to say doch, maybe it still influences, but I...
We can take it for granted that we are being influenced. We should, as devotees, we should feel, yes, I am being influenced. So then what do? Either you can say, oh, I'm being influenced, I don't go out. But then you don't get any mercy. So then what you do is you go out and you say, but I'm being influenced. So then what do? You go out, and then when you come back, you take shelter. You take deeper shelter of the process, you take deeper shelter of the devotees, you take deeper shelter of Prabhupada's books, and you get spiritual strength. Because then you realize, yes, I'm going out, I'm interacting with the material energy, I'm very likely to get influenced. Therefore, I need to take more shelter, I need more mercy, I need more Mahaprasad, I need to be protected. Therefore, we take shelter. You see, like, our process is not to try to escape material influence by staying separate from it. Of course, we're not going to go into some unnecessary situation. But the main thing we're doing as devotees is we're trying to develop a spiritual strength, a spiritual connection that gives us immunity to it. So, yes, when you go out on the street, take it for granted you are being influenced, for sure, because we're not pure devotees. If you are, as Krishna says, mam cha yo vyabhicharena bhakti yogena sevate sagunan samatityetan brahmabhuyaya kalpate. If you are practicing abhyacharini bhakti, uninterrupted, pure devotional service, sagunan, then you're beyond the modes. But if you're not, then the modes are there. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur says, Abhimanyu, you know who is Abhimanyu? Abhimanyu is the son of Arjuna. So when Abhimanyu was fighting in Kurukshetra, he was an expert fighter. So when the Kauravas put together the Chakra Vyuha, this is a very complicated military phalanx, Abhimanyu, he knew how to penetrate the phalanx and fight. But what didn't he know? How to get out. Therefore, Abhimanyu came in and he fought. But what he didn't know is how to get out without getting hurt. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, the preachers of the Krishna consciousness movement, they should not fall to this trap. They should also understand not just how to go into the material energy and fight, but they should know how to come out without being influenced. And so we have to fight because we are spiritual warriors. We have to be. That's what Srila Prabhupada wanted us to do. Here, we're reading from a transcendental diary. Srila Prabhupada was so happy when the devotees were distributing books. You are all becoming very, very dear to my Guru Maharaj. I started this movement by book selling. So we need Prabhupada's mercy. He's saying, if you go out, so you should go out, but you should also take shelter.
somewhere where it's due, I don't feel it.
Even if you don't feel it, you should know by intelligence that it's there, and therefore I should take shelter.
I see. I understand. I got it. Yes, okay. And I take prasad not to think I'm purifying myself. I take prasad to have more strength to go tomorrow.
Both.
I don't like this word purifying.
You don't like the word purifying?
No.
Okay, no problem. We are, this is, purification is, this is actually in the Shastra. That yes, these are all pavanani, let me find that verse for you. This is not our words, this is the words of Krishna. Krishna says we should never give up these things because these things purify the Pavanani Manishinam. Yagyadana tapakarma nyatyajam karyameva tat. Yagyodanam tapascheva pavanani manishinam. Acts of sacrifice, charity and penance are not to be given up. They must be performed. Indeed, sacrifice, prasadam is also a sacrifice. Indeed, sacrifice, charity, and penance purify even the great souls. Not just purifying the impure souls, they even purify the great souls. Pavanani manishinam. Yes, prasadam is Krishna's mercy. Krishna is purifying us. We need purification because I'm contaminated. I'm impure. We have to accept. Therefore, we need the purification. Prabhupada was giving a class and he said, I'll never fall down. You can trust. And then he was in front of the deities praying. And then later on a disciple asked, Srila Prabhupada, what were you praying for? Prabhupada says, I was praying I'd never fall down. But they said, but Prabhupada, in the class you said you will never fall down. Prabhupada said, yes, I will never fall down because I'm always praying. Who are we? We are very weak. I need purification. I am the great souls are saying they're so fallen, they're so lowly. Na prema shravanadi bhaktirapiva yogo tava vaishnavo. I have no love, I have no taste, I have no attachment. I'm arrested by so many material desires. I need your mercy, Krishna. Unless I become purified by your mercy, why would you ever want to even come close to me? To approach the supreme pure, we need to become pure. Otherwise, how we will approach? We will remain far from Krishna. So we need purification, therefore we take shelter of this process. And you're doing the greatest service. You're going out there, out of your way, making a sacrifice to help people. So that's special mercy. You're blessed. Yeah. At the end of life, you know, maybe we'll see Prabhupada and then you can tell him, maybe I'm not such a good devotee, but I try to distribute your books. And then maybe he'll smile and say, okay then. Then you can go. So thank you. Mataji is so enthusiastic. She was distributing outside here. And everyone is part of the Sankirtan movement. You are going out and then devotees are doing the backup and devotees are supporting, devotees are managing the temple. Everyone's a part of the Sankirtan movement. So we're all part of that. And in this way, we can become purified. Thank you. Yes, Mataji.
Maharaj, I'm sorry I was not blessed participating in your class, but I do have a question, if you don't mind.
Yes, of course.
Thank you. So, I heard that it's enough to follow one of the 9 processes of devotional service in order to reach, to please Krishna, to go back home to Godhead. But then Srila Prabhupada also frequently quotes this verse about Maharaj Ambarisha that he was engaging in all the 9 processes. And now when Mataji was asking these questions about purification, the thought came into my mind, is it enough to just follow Bhagavata Vidhi, Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnu Smaranam, or do we also need to follow still also this Pancharatriki Vidhi too to get purified?
Yes, in the Bhagavatam, we understand that there are 9 processes of devotional service, Navavida Bhakti, and the Shastra says, gives examples of individuals who purified themselves just by one process. Shravanam, who was the person who purified themselves by Shravanam, hearing? Parikshit. Who was the one who did it by Kirtanam, speaking? Well, who spoke to him? Sukadev Goswami. Who was the one who purified themselves by Smaranam, remembering? Prahlad. Who was the one who purified themselves by Dasyam, serving? Hanuman. Who was the one who purified themselves by deity worship? Prithu. Who was the one who purified themselves by offering prayers? He went to Vrindavan, yes, Akrura. Who was the one who purified themselves by making friends with Krishna?
Arjuna.
Who was the one who purified themselves by offering everything to Krishna?
Bali
Maharaj. So like this, it's said that just by one process they were. And even when it talks about Pancha Anga Bhakti, it says even one of these processes are sufficient to take one back home, back to Godhead. So in theory, one process is enough. In practice, we need all the mercy we can get. In practice, we are, because we are Mishra Bhaktas or mixed devotees, we are not really able to practice any of the Navavida Bhakti with that kind of purity and intensity. I mean, when Parikshit was hearing, he gave up sleeping, drinking, and he was in rapt attention for 7 days. I mean, for most of us to stay awake in just one class is already a challenge. So you may say, I will purify myself through hearing, but do we have that kind of attention span? Yes, Sukadev Goswami was speaking. I can give a class on the Bhagavatam for 1 hour. Can you do it for 2? Can you do it for 4? Can you do it for 10 hours? Can you do it for 7 days? Do you have that kind of addiction to talking about Krishna? Maybe not. Yeah, I like to serve Krishna, but after 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, we begin to get a little tired. So in theory, one process is enough. In theory, what to speak of one process, one name of Krishna is enough. Eka Krishna Nama Kare Sarva Papa Kshoy. One name of Krishna is enough to annihilate all your sins. But the reality is, we need all the mercy we can get. And therefore, Srila Prabhupada encouraged us to do Pancharatriki Vidhi because it gives us a certain type of purification. Which then allows us to practice Bhagavat Vidhi in greater intensity. And therefore, generally for everyone, both things are going on side by side, Pancharatrik Vidhi and Bhagavat Vidhi. But in this age, we understand that the ultimate release from the material world will come through Bhagavat Vidhi, because Harinama, Harinama, Harinama eva kevalam, kalo nasteva, nasteva. There's no other way than the holy name. But we still take shelter of Pancharatrika Vidhi because it gives us a certain purity and focus which allows us to do our Bhagavad Vidhi with greater depth.